broadcasting from high atop Black Mountain and the Revolting Radio Satellite Service Studios, it's Cooling with the Captain.
Don't you misunderstand me. I just want to say what's on my mind. No need to hit me with an attitude, because I haven't got the time. I want you to know one thing is certain. Take no if that's
Okay, man, it is so mellow and groovy. That is the Yacht Rock set for this weekend. On Coolin' with the Captain, I am your captain, and looking for my Tennille out there. You're going to shout outs for some of those jams because they were so extra shiny. You know what I'm saying? Everybody out there with your dock boots on, your penny loafers, and your ascots, pour yourself a glass of wine or champagne as I do the shout outs for tonight. Where the hell are they? Morgan Freeman, my engineer. Thank you. All right, giving a shout out to Captain Jack Spaniel and Loose Booty and Shooties, Trudy and Scooter and Robson. Scooter and Robson are a couple of my favorite barbecue buddies. I want to give a shout out to them. Also, Dance Janice and Blanche Fernwood, who's staying out there with the Fern Blasters, all on their pontoon boat and having some fun time tonight. That's the Yacht Rock for you on Coolin' with the Captain. All right, now it's time to take a look at a guy I really like. His name is Weird Albert Yankovic, and he's a funny guy who plays a accordion and writes funny lyrics. And you probably know him for changing popular songs into spoof songs. But I'm going to play three songs right now for you that really showcase the freshness of Weird Al Yankovic and his strange mind writing some original tunes with his band, Dare to Be Stupid, I'll Be Mellow When I'm Dead, and The Check's in the Mail on Coolin' with the Captain.
Sometimes part of that vegetarian scene. I won't buy me a pair of designer jeans. No redwood hot tub to my name. I got all that I want, and if it's all the same to you, I don't need a course in self-awareness to find out who I am. And I'd rather have a Big Mac or a Jumbo Jack than all the bean sprouts in Japan.
Like, wow, man, can you relate?
I'll be mellow when I'm dead. 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 I'll be mellow when I'm dead.
Have a seat, have a drink, boy, it's good to see you, what can I say? Oh, sorry, gotta run, we'll get together again. Say, what was your name anyway? Well, we're working on the problem, we'll get back to you soon, yeah. But don't try to call me, I'll be in a meeting every afternoon for a year, maybe longer, keep in touch, just thanks for dropping by and have a nice day. The check's in the mail,
hey,
you're beautiful, don't ever change,
you know what I mean.
We'll call your girl, we'll talk, we'll do lunch, we'll leave a message on my machine. So baby, won't you sign on the dotted line? Gonna make your dreams come true. The check's in the mail, would I lie to you? Well, hey, wait a minute, what's the matter? Hold on, you want me to fork over the loot? You say you hate my guts, you wanna take me to court, and you got yourself a lawyer with a three-piece suit. Well, I'm proud to say you're not the only critic of mine,
yeah.
So if you wanna sue me, I'm afraid you're gonna have to wait in line. Take a number, thanks for calling, who loves you, baby? Don't forget to read the fine print. Say the check's in the mail,
hey!
You're beautiful, don't ever change,
you know what I mean.
My girl will call your girl, we'll talk, we'll do lunch, we'll leave a message. Dotted line, gonna make your dreams come true. The check's in the mail, would I lie to you?
Oh, trust me.
Checks in the mail.
Hey,
you're beautiful, don't ever change,
you know what I mean.
Why don't you leave a message with my girl? I'll have lunch with your machine. So baby, won't you sign on the dotted line? I'm gonna make your dreams come true. The check's in the mail, would I lie to you?
Okay, that was a triple shot for you of Weird Al Yankovic. Two songs from his first album, which is self-titled Weird Al Yankovic, and the first song, Dare to Be Stupid, from the album of the same name, Dare to Be Stupid. And I like those songs a lot, especially The Checks in the Mail. It's got a lot of really good one-liners. And you can hear that the band is really talented and that they can come up with songs that are at least good enough to play at a bar mitzvah, right? All right. Cooling with the Captain. I'm the Captain Freeznot. You're listening to us on Freeznotable Pop Culture TV and the Revolting Radio Satellite Studios. Now we're going to do our grunge set for the weekend, followed by We Interrupt This Broadcast, hosted by Bill Curtis. But first, I want to remind you that if you like history, rock and roll history stuff, then check out Graveyard Shift, because they're doing 1969, if you haven't already heard, 1968. Check that out. It's up on the channel. 1968 spotlight for the Graveyard Shift, but 1969 is coming up after my show later on tonight or tomorrow morning or whenever I get around to it. Yeah, that's how it is. What, you got a problem? Oh, I'm sorry. I just had a little foofmonger there of the brain. And now, let's get in it, huh? I'm serious, though. I'm really excited about this. I don't know why. I'm kind of like a little schoolgirl in that way. But I hope that's the only way I'm like a little schoolgirl. But this is grunge rock, but it's like grunge for surfers. You like, or guys who like don't even surf, but like hang around the beach. You know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about that Goleta, Southern Santa Barbara, Isla Vista, Northern California, Ventura, San Luis Obispo, and San Francisco style that we're going to get into right now. You got to hear it in their voices. It's kind of like a punk surf kind of. And the other thing is it's kind of like early stoner rock flavor of this, too. It's just real sexy, smooth stuff. And we're going to start it off with these guys who lived up the street from me. This is Summer Camp with Drawer.
Just a drawer. Richard M. Nixon's career seemed to thrive on paradox. He was a man famous for his lack of personal grace, yet he became the only candidate in U.S. history who was twice elected both president and vice president. In the moments of his greatest triumph, he planted the seeds of future self-destruction, while his most public failures only seemed to gird his determination to mount ever more astonishing comebacks. In November 1972, Nixon was re-elected president in a landslide, carrying 49 of 50 states. But in the midst of that election campaign, Nixon's paranoia and distrust led to his downfall. Determined not to be blindsided by political dirty tricks, he planted one of his own, authorizing a burglary attempt of the Democratic Party headquarters at Washington's Watergate Hotel. The intruders were caught, setting into motion a White House cover-up which would take 2 years to unravel. Yet unravel it did, leading to televised Senate hearings with all the drama of a daily soap opera. By the summer of 1974, many of Nixon's top aides had resigned and were under legal indictment. Finally, a tape recording system Nixon had installed in the White House provided evidence that the president had been involved in the cover-up all along.
This is an NBC News hotline report. This is Steve Porter. The rapidly unfolding events in Washington point to the resignation of President Richard Nixon today. An announcement was made at the White House a short time ago, and on the line with me to discuss that is NBC News White House correspondent Russ Ward in Washington.
Yes, Steve, there's no doubt in anyone's mind now that the resignation announcement will be forthcoming tonight. We were informed at 11 o'clock this morning, Eastern Time, that the president had called the vice president into his Oval Office for a private meeting. That private meeting lasted an hour and 10 minutes. A short time later, Press Secretary Ronald Ziegler came into the briefing room and had this announcement.
Tonight at 9 o'clock, Eastern Daylight Time, the President of the United States will address the nation on radio and television from his Oval Office.
Facing near certain impeachment, Nixon spoke on television to the American people on August 8, 1974, and announced that he would become the first president in U.S. history to resign from that office.
I have never been a quitter. To leave office before my term is completed is abhorrent to every instinct in my body. But as president, I must put the interests of America first. America needs a full-time president and a full-time Congress, particularly at this time with problems we face at home and abroad. To continue to fight through the months ahead for my personal vindication would almost totally absorb the time and attention of both the President and the Congress in a period when our entire focus should be on the great issues of peace abroad and prosperity without inflation at home. Therefore, I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow.
1 month later, Nixon's successor, Gerald Ford, closed the Watergate saga by granting Nixon a presidential pardon.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have come to a decision which I felt I should tell you and all of my fellow American citizens. As soon as I was certain in my own mind and in my own conscience that it is the right thing to do. There are no historic or legal precedents to which I can turn in this matter. None that precisely fit the circumstances of a private citizen who has resigned the presidency of the United States. Now, therefore, I, Gerald R. Ford, President of the United States, pursuant to the pardon power conferred upon me by Article 2, Section 2 of the Constitution, have granted, and by these presents do grant, a full, free, and absolute pardon unto Richard Nixon for all offenses against the United States which he, Richard Nixon, has committed or may have committed or taken part in during the period from July 20, 1969 through August 9, 1974.
For several years after that, Nixon slipped from view, and many observers assumed that his public career had ended at last. And yet, slowly but surely, he came back once more. In 1993, he returned to the House of Representatives and began his speech by humorously echoing General Douglas MacArthur's famous farewell. "Old politicians may die," he told the assembled congressmen, "but they never fade away."
From out of the past, on a moon jet from out of bound, I try to relax. When my church runs me out of town,
yeah. Our crowd still attracts a crowd.